All right. Again, thank you all for coming. So my name is Jacob Hickman. I'm a professor of anthropology, one of the newer faculty members in the anthropology department. So Leif is a good friend of mine. We've been friends for a couple of years. He's also an associate professor of anthropology in the School of Human Evolution and Social Change at Arizona State, a larger ominous entity that has sort of, I suppose in his characterization, gobbled up anthropology in some institutional sense. But Leif's research focused on the hinterland farming populations in mainland Southeast Asia. And his work has included understanding the dynamics of identity, cultural practice, and social life at the intersections of minority communities and state structures. The focus of this work has ranged among regional history and contemporary identity work and political protest. And most of this research has dealt with Yumeyan people in Thailand, a group that's very close to my heart because of the close ethno-linguistic and historical relationships with Hmong and so on, as well as with the Yumeyan in the United States, with the refugee and diasporic community from Laos. He has produced a video documentary on Festival of Sports and Culture that brought together representatives of Mien from all over Thailand. The title of that is Mien Sports and Heritage. And his writing also includes his books, important books in the field of Southeast Asian studies, or one particular, Mien Relations, Mountain People, and State Control in Thailand, and another which he co-edited on contests and context, readings in the anthropology of sports. And he's working on a really interesting book that I haven't seen the manuscript, but we've talked about it at length, that I think is something of a critique of this entire anthropological enterprise, which I'm really looking forward to. And I think one of the reasons that we're particularly interested, both the faculty and in the Asian Studies program as well as us, is because Leif has been one of the more vocal and important critics of a book that's made rather a large splash in both the popular world as well as the academic world, James C. Scott's recent book, The Art of Not Being Governed, which it is in part, I think, what we're going to hear from Leif is a critique of that. So we're really excited to have him. So let's welcome Leif Jonsson.
Thank you all. Thank you for coming, and thank you to Asian Studies and Anthropology for bringing me here. And I must say, I'm thrilled to be brought into a local ritual. This is what happens. This is what happens in fieldwork when people are doing sports festivals or anything, and they bring me in and make me a part of it, and that's how sometimes I learn things. So I'm concerned here with the intersections of anthropology and Asian studies, and as you just heard, I'm concerned with this book, The Art of Not Being Governed, An Anarchist History of Upland Southeast Asia. And this is James Scott's work on Asian hinterlands as Zomia, as he calls it, a diverse region of people who had for millennia, he suggested, managed to stay away from the state. And I'm in the resistance league, as I will try to explain. But I've been reading up on debates in my discipline of anthropology, debates on the work of Margaret Mead and Napoleon Chagnon, Clifford Geertz, Marshall Sahlins. And it seems to me we learn nothing from these debates. People come into rival camps, and it sort of ends there. And the social reality that the debate was about kind of fades into the background, and I think that's a missed opportunity. So I see no recommendation for entering into a fight of my own. Now, in the briefest terms, what Jim Scott is doing is he's reconsidering what Western scholarship had earlier approach as a tribal zone of ethnic minority peoples characterized by their linguistic and cultural diversity and non-modern forms of farming, such as so-called slash and burn cultivation. In a bold move, Scott declares that all our views were clouded by primitivism and state rhetoric. And he proceeds to decode step by step how Highlander ways of farming, social organization, linguistic diversity, the lack of written language, and millenarian religious movements are each a strategy of attaining egalitarianism and a separation from the lowland state. Don't rush to look for yourself, though, because he says this all came to an end by 1950 because of the modern state having modern technologies of road construction, surveillance, and control. So I'm still learning the new technology of flipping slides. But things come out differently if we don't assume a binary of being either inside or outside the state, but rather envision vast gray areas and ask what kinds of relations did people have across ethnic and political boundaries. And from this angle, which I'll be talking about today, the story shifts. It appears that the modern nation state largely destroyed long passable avenues of negotiating relationships. So it's not, I suggest, it's not so much that the state incorporated an outside, but rather that it marginalized and denied connections to certain people who were already there. So Scott's binary of the state and the Highlanders requires a leap of faith, away from various local specificities of time and place and people. And a part of what I do here is to ask, where does this leap of faith take his readers and the peoples of Southeast Asia? What kind of academic book of revelations has he produced, and how does it serve the people it celebrates? So ultimately, this is the cover of an introductory textbook in anthropology, and these are kids in a Hmong village in Thailand. Nothing in this book has any content on the Hmong. There's no reference to Thailand. But this is the cliche. You put a photo of some kiddos in a tribal village, and that's an introduction to anthropology. It's all same, same. That Asia is an object of Western knowledge. And if we examine the realm of representation and suspend the notion of neutral facts, it seems that we have entered a domain where imperialist and other notions from both the colonial time and the Vietnam War are being recycled without notice. And we don't notice because they enable products for a competitive academic market. They fuel divisions within competitive academic disciplines, and they create relations of trust between an author and his or her readers. The readers are looking to come into identity as knowledgeable and not gullible, and their preconceived notions of where deception comes from sets us up to not recognize the dangerous game that we all play. So the issue of Zomia, the Highland region, is only partly empirical, I suggest, or it's empirical only in terms of our own understanding of the state, the flow of history, so-called tribal peoples, and of ourselves and society. And many Westerners take for granted a basic tension between the state and the people and view the state as out there to impinge on people's freedom. From this angle, Scott's case is immediately acceptable and also quite exciting because he has discovered an area above and beyond the state with, quote, a minority population of around 80 million to 100 million. Its peoples are fragmented into hundreds of ethnic identities and at least five language families that defy any simple classification, unquote. And then he situates the state on the landscape for us. The state was tyrannical, but episodically so. Physical flight, the bedrock of popular freedom, was the principal check on state power. Subjects who were sorely tried by conscription, forced labor, and taxes would typically move away to the hills or to a neighboring kingdom rather than revolt. So here, in some ways, because Scott came into prominence or academic reputation dealing with peasant rebellions and things like that, what you have is the absence of revolt is his puzzle. That's what he tries to explain to us without necessarily flagging that issue. Now, the analytical and descriptive premise of the state out to impinge on people and people running into the hills sets Southeast Asia in motion, Southeast Asian history in motion, as it animates the ethnology, the account of what kinds of people there are and what can happen to them in interaction. And I think the book prospects through the ruins of Southeast Asian ethnography for dramatic lessons about the world, on the assumption that states are oppressive and that this oppression's antithesis, freedom, lies in strategies of evading the state's grasp. And these came to an end by about 1950, he says, when, with better technologies, the state brought all these Highland peoples to heel, which sounds like dealing with wild horses or things like that. Such expectations are common. He's not inventing the wheel here. They seem authoritative, and they may offer peculiar delights to Westerners feeling themselves modern, democratic, and enlightened against the backdrop of the brutalities and oppression of Western colonialism and ancient China. And here's a quote from Edward Schaeffer, who's a really remarkable scholar of China. He was writing about China during the Tang, 8th century. And he's writing about the South, where the Mian people and the Hmong people are. Here's the quote. The soldiers who kept the Tang Chinese yoke on the necks of the indigents were by no means all Hua men, the ostensible ethnic majority. Many of them were the native neighbors and natural allies of the people held in subjection. As Cortes used the Totonac people against the Aztec in Mexico, so did the Chinese employ some of the aboriginal subjects to bring others into subjection. Everything in this paragraph is identical to the rhetoric of Scott's analysis. So it's not new. Now, Scott's case, let's give you another image here. Scott's case assumes that taxation is oppressive extraction. This view, I thought about, where have I heard this before? This view is analogous to what some of my Christian Mian friends say about their previous religious practice of ancestor worship, that spirits and spirit mediums keep extracting resources from people, and that for so long as people don't know better, they will have themselves robbed because they're gullible and easily misled. My response is that of a Mian ethnographer, that Mian people have had various kinds of relations with spirits. There are many different kinds of spirits, and you have to specify what situation you're talking about. Now, so I think we are easily kind of brought into this framework of Scott's study because we assume that the tribal frontier, the ethnic frontier, is a particular configuration of power and inequality. So for a comparative perspective on underlying notions of power and difference and how they produce historical scenarios, I want to compare Zomia against understandings of gender. So here I draw on historian Joan Scott. That was my reason for pitting Scott versus Scott. And so here's a quote from her. Gender is the social organization of sexual difference. By assuming that women have inherent characteristics and objective identities consistently and predictably different from men's, and that these generate definably female needs and interests, historians imply that sexual difference is a natural rather than a social phenomenon. And he goes on, feminist history insists on the need to examine gender concretely and in context and consider it as a historical phenomenon produced, reproduced, and transformed in different situations over time. The story is no longer about the things that have happened to women and men and how they have responded to them, but rather about how the subjective and collective meanings of women and men as categories of identity have been constructed, unquote. And with that, I take you to southern China in the past. So I'm relying here on historian David Foer, who has been looking at southern China in the archives for decades. And he finds no regularity in the position of Yao, or Mian people, as inside or outside the state, upland or lowland. This was in each case a matter of various local arrangements and histories. And because he's been reading quite widely, he finds there's no commonality between Guilin and Hunan and Yunnan provinces. So the position of the Yao people isn't there in the abstract. And as soon as one abandons the categorical certainty of the Chinese and the state, then the obviousness of the Yao as a historical actor dissolves. But Foer has an intimate knowledge of the archives, and he's come to know some of the personalities and issues, and he's looked at the so-called Yao rebellions, Yao wars, sorry, in the 15th and 16th centuries. And he found something quite scary. So the so-called Yao wars were the result of squabbles and tensions within the elite in Guangxi, and one of them, against his rivals at the court, conjured up a notion of a national security threat, that because he had connections to the eunuchs at the court in Beijing, he was the innermost circle of the Beijing elite and mobilized them to send an army of 60,000 people, and he was able to amass an army of 130,000 people within Guangxi. And the result was that 800 Yao people were arrested and 3,200 beheaded. And there was nothing there. He made up, he cooked up the national security threat, and he becomes a darling of the elite in Beijing. And he's a defender of national security. And these kinds of stories may take decades for scholars to figure out. And they may not be easily accessible to the average Western academic reader who is not inherently interested in some 15th century particulars of state lineage tensions in the Pearl River Delta. So my assumption here is that the notion of history as a stage where the state acts against the people may misconstrue the whole landscape. So the case for Zomia is a particularly American rendering of Southeast Asia for a national audience. And this can come clearer with some Japanese contrast. So one major Japanese study of Yao manuscripts and histories in Thailand in the late 60s was led by Shiratori Yoshiro from Sofia University. And it, quote, yielded a collection of almost 2,000 items of ethnological material, tens of thousands of photographs, as well as many copies of ancient Yao documents. One motive behind this research effort was the possibility that the actual origins of the non-Chinese tribes in Central and South China and Southeast Asia and the shift from dry rice to wet rice agriculture would help solve, directly or indirectly, the origins of the Wajin and therefore the formative process of Japanese society and culture. So the various ramifications of rice cultivation are very important for Japanese scholarship and also for Japanese self-image. And Shiratori's research project in Thailand during 1967 and 68 has a precursor in a multi-investigator Japanese project on rice culture in Southeast Asia that studied Vietnam, Cambodia, and Laos in 57 and 58. I do not suggest that scholarship is a reflection of national realities. Instead, it is an active prospecting for particular kinds of identity and difference that draws on and draws up ethnological types to situate certain positions within social life that makes other issues disappear. There's no average Japanese and there's no average American any more that there is an average Southeast Asian Highlander. But scientific funding agencies and the reading public can be stirred into enthusiastic support for research showing certain important things, such as look into the national past or look into the human past. Japan was being reestablished after the devastation of World War II. And what more delightful and inspiring destruction from the rubble than a look into the evolution of Japanese society by Southeast Asian proxy? Scholarship on Asian hinterlands can inform national prospecting that plays to particular interests and may unite people as easily as it may divide them. Now, the case for Zomia is to many people an exciting discovery that brings a view on themselves and others and the world. It recycles, unwittingly, nationalist rhetoric of fundamental ethnic divisions in the process of enabling the reader's political enlightenment. It may have been intended as a positive offering or an offering of positive regional legacy to the Karen people suffering the ethnic conflict in Burma, but it ultimately, in my view, renders social collapse and political failure as fate. This is all rather tragic, as is the scenario of college students in the West coming into knowledge about Asia from this book. The students most likely view the Vietnam War as an alien past, and the book allows them to head into the figurative hills and shout, "Live free or die," before going home for dinner. I think this is the problem, that we can forget the particulars of any war and slide into a drama about freedom on the frontier to whose characters we have no responsibilities. And my assessment, which I'll try to justify in what follows, is that we've all been rather careless because we are caught up in the dynamics of a competitive market that is focused on academic products, the stuff that makes or breaks academic careers, and on academic factions, rather than recognizing more carefully how academic representations mediate among the world of research sites in Asia, in this case, academic worlds, which is our universities, and our home societies. And my inspiration here came from a weekend spent reading Relativity by Albert Einstein, where he says time and space have no independent existence. There's only the structural quality of a particular field. So, to offer an alternative to James Scott's recent analysis and to place it in some perspective, I try to answer these three questions. Were Highlanders running away from the state? Is the state out to oppress and subjugate people? And was there a watershed moment around 1950 when the Asian state went from a weak arm to a strong, long arm, into complete reach into all the nooks and crannies of previous escape and freedom? And what about Scott's argument that Highlanders' patterns of culture, agriculture, social organization, and religion enabled their evasion from the state's tentacles, that these were all strategies of escape? So I'll start with Thailand to show how our sense of Highlanders as separate from the state is the outcome of very specific histories that they're not of long standing. So when Mien and Hmong and Lahu and Lisu and Akha peoples were establishing themselves in northern Thailand in the late 19th century and the early 20th centuries, some were able to make contracts with the rulers of lowland kingdoms and provincial governors. A large group of Mien and Hmong people arrived from northern Laos, having sojourned ultimately from Guangxi in southern China. I'll bring the map back up in a minute. They sojourned from Guangxi in southern China to northern Vietnam, up into Yunnan, down to northern Laos, and over to Thailand, to Nan province. In exchange for a payment and the promise to be a backup army and tribute collectors for the king, their leader received a permit for his people to settle in the highlands that belonged to the king of Nan, and later Nan becomes a province. The Mien leader of this migration and other large farmers in five villages were given a permit to grow poppy, opium, and to sell the proceeds to tax farmers under the royal opium monopoly. And that's the start of the story. So I'm sorry for all this text on the slide here. Only farmers with big households were considered worthy of this trade connection. No one else qualified. In other words, certain people in five settlements were, for 60, 70 years, legal poppy growers. Everybody else, people of various ethnicities in maybe 2,000, 3,000 settlements, were illegal and vulnerable to official abuse. Mien fellow villages and small households, Mien, Hmong, Lisu, Lahu, Akha, and other poppy-growing Highlanders in northern Thailand were continually at risk of arrest and official abuse and exposed to police demands for payment. And the arrests of illegal poppy growers can be traced back to the early years of the 20th century. So I think, you know, I've been at this for a while. It seems to me that the isolated Highland peoples that inform most 20th century ethnography were the result of how the Thai nation state had actively undone previous relations into the Highlands. By 1900, Bangkok takes over a number of independent kingdoms and turns them into provinces. Government officials came exclusively from Bangkok, and they did not make an effort to establish any relations other than those of Bangkok superiority. They didn't learn local languages or anything. With the exception of the five Mien settlements, most Highlanders across northern Thailand stood outside any relations with lowland structures and instead dealt with Chinese traders, caravan traders, who exchanged various goods for Highlanders' opium. This dynamic, a combination of regular trade and a black market, went on for many decades, and it accentuated what seemed to be the natural isolation of exotic peoples in the forested mountains that ethnographers then made into their discovery. Each of them studies a tribe. The black market was independent of the state, but it responded to how national society denied accommodation to Highlanders. It delayed negotiation across Highland difference, which may have contributed to the enormous violence when Highlands are finally incorporated between the 60s and 80s. Let's see if I have a picture here. Here are my Mien people. Between 1968 and 1980s, Thai Highlanders were the object of considerable discrimination and military violence, on the assumption that they were alien border crossers, communist sympathizers, rebels, opium growers, and a threat to the national environment, and much more. The notion of hill tribes as a national threat served to mobilize hostile, aggressive, and violent forces and to focus them on Highland farmers as much as against student activists in Bangkok or Chiang Mai, labor organizers, and peasant advocates. The typecasting of a threat not only brought violence against the Hmong and others, it also, importantly, denied various kinds of diversity within Thai society. So in my view, these are political pathologies that express neither nation nor state, but can instead shape them, the nation and the state, in particular ways with specific destructive consequences. The violence, in my view, does not reflect the state or the Thai. Instead, a particular ethnological typecasting set in motion a new shape to national society that was anchored to fear and hostility and denied the possibility of peaceful coexistence. Bangkok elites have been taking over several times. Around 1900, it destroyed a number of northern kingdoms and their networks of relations into the hills. The violence in the 60s to 80s was not a continuation of how the Asian state has been out to catch the free Highlanders. Quite the contrary, the two-part process eliminated, for the most part, channels of connection between hills and valleys. The isolation of Highlanders was actively produced by these hostile policies. It was no sign of successful escape. And that's my basic point. Now, the Mian I work with in Thailand had migrated from Guangxi province in southern China by 1870 or so. I'll bring the map back up here. So Guangxi is up here. And they zigzagged down into Vietnam, up back into China, down into Laos, and over to where it says Nan. This group had moved in search of new land, and the process enabled leadership positions to aspiring men who could forge a contract with a lowland king. And if successful, this would bring them the title Paya, chief. The Mian people I know have similar assumptions behind their religion and their politics. One makes particular relations for specific benefits. The relations have to be initiated, and then they have to be annually maintained with some gifts, and it becomes a relationship over time. Without establishing relations to ancestor spirits, people have no access to soul stuff, that which animates people and crops and keeps them healthy and prosperous, and is the precondition for being able to exchange blessings at feasts. Beyond ancestors, there are village owner spirits, there are soldier spirits, there's spirit government, and in one case, there's a king spirit. These are particular relationships and particular frameworks that an attempt to generalize Mian religion would completely flatten and decontextualize. It would be the same with the notion of Mian politics, and I think this is what happened with the Zomian politics. It's completely flat. It's nowhere in particular. So some history of the people I was with. By the 1870s, people moved, they came into a relationship with a king spirit. This was during a crisis situation somewhere in northern Vietnam where there's an army of so-called black flag warlords, mercenaries out of southern China. And the people learn that this is coming, so the leader of the Mian group, he makes a hasty offering to the spirit of the king of the domain where they were at the time. And when the attack comes, he's invulnerable. The Chinese aim their guns at him. He's magically transported somewhere else. They re-aim, he flies off. And he knocks off this attack. He's invulnerable, he's invincible, and he obviously has a unique spiritual connection. And this makes him into a very successful leader. So he maintains a relationship with this king spirit. So as he moves, he takes up different kings as his spirit. The only reason I found out is that 120 years later, the people I was staying with maintained this relationship. Only direct descendants have access to this spirit. But the deal and the potential benefits is framed by social context. You know, it went from invulnerability in the 1870s to finding somebody's stolen motorbike in the 1990s. It's not the same thing. In recent years, I've been working with Mian refugees from Laos who are living on the west coast of the U.S. And I found out they come from the same migration out of Guangxi province, people who settled into various domains across this landscape you see on the map, from southern China to Vietnam, Laos, and Thailand. Many Mian leaders became chiefs, one or more per lowland kingdom, of which there were scores of kingdoms there. The rulers were mostly Thai speakers. Thai Kun, Thai Lu, Thai Nu, Lao, Yuan, and so on. And it seems very clear that these lowland rulers had a place for Highlanders in their political framework, and they cultivated these relations for exchange of mutual benefits. It's also rather clear that lowland rulers controlled access to the mountains around them. The separation between hill and valley that Scott assumes is not affirmed in these histories. People had to make a deal to be able to settle in the mountains. And a king could accept or reject proposals, and they could try to attract a promising population with a title and trade privileges and so on. Now, the plot thickens. In Laos, where Mien and Hmong were settling in the 1870s and 80s, there had been long-standing relations with so-called Ka peoples, Kamu, Lamet, and others. And those came to a violent end in 1879, so 14 years before the French arrived. There's a fight between the viceroy and the king of Luang Prabang, and the king went off to Bangkok to negotiate some political deal with the Thai king. And meanwhile, there's a fight with the Kamu, and the viceroy has over 100 Kamu headmen executed one fine day. With that, all the connections to Kamu of Laos disappeared. And when the king comes back, there's nothing there. This was not the state acting. This was tension within the elite playing out in violence that destroyed particular networks of relations. When the French colonials took over Laos in 1893, they came to build relations with Hmong and Mien peoples and to slight the Kamu. And at least one Mien leader who had considerable military prowess helped the French suppress the Akka, who didn't want to pay the tax. And the Akka never had much recognition within colonial Laos. These are very particular historical accidents that have different consequences for people in different places. So the French are there, and the French are running their colonial regime partly on the proceeds of the opium monopoly. The French were building museums in Paris for the money from the opium monopoly in Laos. Hmong and Mien were the major suppliers of opium. And the system benefited chiefs much more than it did commoners. The French were taxing everyone, and Mien friends recall from some older people that sometimes times were so rough that an ordinary poor family would have to sell off a child for adoption to pay the tax. They also said that the Akka would come do wage work for them, and particularly for big households, and that in those days, many Mien people learned to speak the Akka language. The Akka, who were harder up and more marginal than the Mien, not only had to sell off their children to afford the tax, they also had to do field work, farm work, for others to make ends meet, which means they didn't have time to work in their own fields. So it's a multiple, complex set of relations going on here. So only some Mien people could come into relations with lowland valley kings, and even fewer could come into relations with the French. On the Thai side at the time, where it says Nan and Chiang Rai, three Mien leaders were granted the Payat title, chief. But only one of them came into a rewarding relationship through an opium monopoly, recognized settlement, later ID papers, village registration, land rights, and the rest of it. Coming into these relations is at a cost, somewhat like the differentiated relationship with ancestor spirits or village guardians or king spirits, spirit government, and so on. There is no average Mien religious framework, nor is there an average Mien household. But my partial evidence from ethnohistorical interviews suggests that big households of 80 or more people, one in Thailand and perhaps a dozen on the Laos side, emerged through rivalries among ambitious would-be leaders who were on this migration from Guangxi to Vietnam, Laos, Yunnan, and Thailand. The big household is a feature of a specific historical moment over two generations, between 1890 and 1940, when a feudal system was being replaced by opium monopolies as the node linking upland regions into larger worlds. And they had 80 or more people. That's 10 times the size of a regular household. And if you could assemble such a household, you could make deals with an opium monopoly. Everybody else is outside registered trade frameworks, is therefore technically illegal. Now, so what does all this nitpicking in historical detail mean for understanding the Asian hinterlands? It seems clear that ordinary people were to some extent dependent on their leaders for negotiating settlement rights, as the leaders were dependent on their followers in order to impress a king into a contract. Nothing in my case material suggests a binary of freedom and oppression. Some Highland peoples were significantly taxed and oppressed, but this varied within and among settlements as well as among ethnic groups. Prior to the French, political relations were about contracts for mutual benefit. And after the French left and Laos was independent, the Lao elite could not agree on a future for the country. Their disagreements escalated into violence, and rival sides came to draw on the resources of international allies, North Vietnam and the Soviet Union on one hand, and Thailand and the US on the other. Many Hmong and Mien people had, through their leaders, been within the folds of the Royal Lao government. They joined militias that were set up, trained, and financed by the CIA. At war's end, they mostly left because the new elite was as unaccommodating of internal diversity and as vengeful as the one it replaced. Laos as a country was profoundly torn apart and destroyed. Burma has increasingly been torn apart, and you might say destroyed too, by ethnicized civil war that goes back to the 1940s. And as long as the rival sides have the resources to keep going, there's no end in sight. So this should be about two-thirds in here. This is a representation from Thailand. We can talk about it afterwards. The art of not being governed is a representation that creates a shared universe, a community of understanding. This community comes together because of shared ideas, among them convictions about colonial and post-colonial ideologies that stereotype some people as backward and primitive, of state power and as oppressive, and as of history in the tribal zone as about violence, oppression of difference. This may enable the reshaping of some American identities through an encounter with the Southeast Asian hinterland that completely sidesteps the divisive issue of the Vietnam War. And here, I'm going to need some water, because we're getting serious. So I offer you a contrast to Scott's model of what Southeast Asia is about and the Highlanders. This is from Timothy Castle, who was with the CIA and is a military historian, writing about different players in the war in Laos after the war was over. He says, Americans solicited these Highland guerrilla fighters. Still, U.S. policymakers cannot be held completely responsible for the Hmong losses. The elite in Vientiane and Luang Prabang, meaning the Lao elite, who openly viewed the mountain people as little more than savages, were quite willing to sit back and allow their Hmong surrogates to fight the communist trespassers. After all, the lowland Lao army rarely possessed the determination to stand and fight effectively against the North Vietnamese. Moreover, communist proscriptions were anathema to the Hmong way of life. U.S. involvement increased the level of violence, but even without American assistance, most of Bang Bao's Hmong clans would have resisted the North Vietnamese. And here we get into even more dangerous territory. I need another sip. Sorry. Take this against Alfred McCoy's representation of the Hmong and Mien leaders of ethnic militias in that war as sinister and self-serving CIA mercenary commanders and heroin manufacturers, unquote. Rather than tell us that the lives of Hmong, Jirai, Americans, or any other people were profoundly destroyed and changed by the American war in Southeast Asia, academics offer the readers dramatic contrast of strong and weak soldiers, freedom and oppression, or honest people versus evil characters who have brought a major drug problem on the world. Coordinates through which the readers can situate themselves on emotional grounds and backed by the facts. There's the more general issue of whether Asian states have always been oppressive and extractive, subjugating the masses in order to extract from them resources. What does it mean for a white Western scholar to say such a thing? Colonial-era Western observers often commented on some Asian authorities as unfit to rule. And the examples include this one from 1903 from missionary Lillian Johnson Curtis, who remarked, "The ruling class of northern Thailand have a dignity and refinement of manner that would be for them a passport into the elegant society of any capital city. But they are a selfish, self-seeking class and have not the interest of their people at heart. the parasitical life of the rulers is the cause of a state of stagnation, unquote. In declaring the state exploitative, Scott is drawing on an Asian material to argue a particular minority position within Western political science. Many of his colleagues focus on national elections, founding fathers like Abraham Lincoln, or the Civil War, and offer no critical angle on the state. Scott's position in internal divisions in academic work and his relationship to his readers, who appreciate being able to side with the people and against the oppressive state, and thus come into agency and political position in their own Western educated urban world, calls attention away from the parallel universe of what politics in Asia may be about, and from what rhetoric is being recycled by declaring Asian states oppressive. The conceptual scaffolding for the case for Zomia echoes Western imperialist projects in Southeast Asia, and no one notices because we, the Western readers, assume that social obligations and institutions are the opposite of our personal freedom, that our understanding of ourselves as Western, educated, and liberal is the test of the case for Zomia, its source of validity, resonance, and importance. Southeast Asia has always been multi-ethnic, but here comes my discipline as a source of our troubles. Anthropology, first describing separate races, then separate ethnic groups, and now the marginalization and governmentality that flow from the neoliberal governmental regime, has not been a politically optimistic project, nor has it been interested in peaceful multi-ethnic accommodations. To a large degree, scholars have taken for granted the ethnic divisions that the colonial era set in motion and was reproduced by the nation state, because it gives us a clear case. I can write about the Mian people. The problems of Zomia are in many and complex ways inherent in how Western scholarship has for generations mediated among Asian materials, academic credentials, and the relationship that scholars have with segments of their own divided societies. Representation is the human predicament. The world is made meaningful through representations that produce particular communities of understanding, sharing, motivation, and pleasure. Pointing is what makes humans unique. Apes don't point. Prelingual human infants point for two reasons. One is declarative. I want Jews over there. And the other is that they want the adult to share attention with them in some interesting event and object, which is two people and an object that they're interested in, an inner subjective world that happens before humans have language. And I'm saying academic books are representations of a similar kind. Like an infant pointing, they are an invitation into an interactive world of shared journeys and destinations. They're, in my case, among three worlds: Asian societies, academia, and the US or other Western societies. And many admire and celebrate James Scott for his handle on the state and on resistance. But the case for Zomia rests on political fatalism that has rendered the Thai, the Burmese, Vietnamese, Lao, Khmer, and Chinese lowland populations as stuck in tracks of oppression and exploitation and out to subjugate their highland neighbors. I ask what makes the highland people run away, and my historical and ethnographic exploration yields only particular examples of antagonism and the denial of basic recognition and equality, often coupled with militarized violence. These are not characteristics of the state in general or Asian nations in particular, but cases of political breakdown that could happen anywhere. James Scott has drawn on an impressive range of historians and anthropologists for his Zomia image. All of us are implicated, complicit, in naturalizing the ethnic divisions that are sometimes set in motion. The pressures of academic careers, coupled with factionalism in Western academia and society, has made us generally blind to what is at stake. So coming into shared understandings of ourselves, others, and the world through representations of Asian societies and histories is my reason to posit Scott versus Scott. Either politics across difference is a foregone conclusion of unequal strength and incompatible character, or it is a site for fashioning a world of tension, possibility, mutual benefit, and potential equality, where different people can mix and create for each other some interesting destinations and distractions. And as an anthropologist, I wish to revisit the idea of a Southeast Asian culture. Anthony Wallace, in 1970, defined culture as turbulent, constantly oscillating between ecstasies of revitalization and the agonies of decline, and shifting in policy from generation to generation with kaleidoscopic variety. He insists that culture is not the replication of uniformity, but the organization of diversity. And he says it's policy tacitly and gradually concocted by groups of people for the furtherance of their interests, and contract established by practice between and among individuals to organize their strivings into mutually facilitating equivalent structures. So he insists that both individuals and groups are diverse, with many of them in continuous and overt conflict in one subsystem and active cooperation in another. This suggests none of the apolitical group-mindedness that the culture concept was critiqued and dismissed for. Instead, it invokes something along the lines of Bruno Latour's networks that are continually shifting, where no component or constellation can be taken for granted and no politics can be known beforehand. The reason this is so easily ignored is that it doesn't enable any EC research methods nor political credentials at a distance, but instead suggests the need for involvement, curiosity, and deep familiarity, one unstable and unpredictable setting at a time. If Southeast Asian culture is not a matter of separate ethnic traditions or of the struggle between freedom and oppression, but of what arrangements people have come up with across difference for mutual benefit at particular moments and in specific settings, then we may arrive at a way to reclaim both Southeast Asia as a region and a positive role for anthropology. Recognizing the effective sides of academic work may be awkward given our biases, but I think the issue comes down to what worlds we can imagine and wish for, given what we know, and whom a scholar invites along when pointing to some imagined community by Asian proxy. If we abandon the categorical certainties about the Han Chinese or the Thai and so on, which prop up expectations of ethnic antagonism, and instead look at individual cases of how particular Chinese rulers and Yao or Mian relate, what do we find? And I'm winding up, so I'm just sort of seeing if I can make you smile. It's either that we're all in trouble or that one of us is right and the other wrong. So, I went to translations of some of these histories and chronicles, and I found early 19th century episode from Guangxi where a local ruler, his scribe is writing it down in the annals. And every year at New Year, a Yao leader from on the mountain would bring 100 men with him, all decked up very nicely, each of them carrying baskets bamboo baskets filled with tailed rabbits, deer, stags, roebucks, foxes, ring pheasants, and rabbits to present to the Mandarin to ring in the New Year. And there was a pattern to what followed. They are presented with savory food, wine, and cakes. They drink their fill and leave, carrying the leftover cakes and biscuits with them in their long sleeves. And I read this as saying that people actively made relations across ethnic frontiers, and such relations could produce mutual benefit and peaceful coexistence. Both the Yao and the Mandarin ruler are putting on a performance for each other, and they're making the relationship with exchange across difference. There are various reasons why they might be motivated. One is that these Yao areas were the homeland of most of the fragrant wood that went into making incense, which was a high-priced commodity on the national and international market at the time. And if the Yao didn't have connections, they were vulnerable to raids on their settlements. There were bandits roaming around, and they would take all your rice and all your pigs away. So you've got to make connections across this divide. And I think with that, it is not an issue of freedom or oppression. There's a vast middle ground between these two extremes. What I learned from Scott's book, I'm one of the sources. I'm one of the people he draws on to make the case. And what it reveals to me is how easily I, as an academic trying to get a job and get a promotion and things like that, how easily I can, for the purposes of a publication, provide an inventory of Thai chauvinism against Highland peoples from everyday life, from the media, from the museums. This gives me a case or an illustration. But in doing so, I may be availing Western readers with no stake in Thai society a conviction that the Thai are racist, against which the reader will feel enlightened and liberal and not implicated and at risk. And I don't want this to be true. So I'm now currently trying to disentangle the cases of antagonism to show that it doesn't inhere in society or ethnicity or nation or the state. These have to be specified unless we want to slide into the fatalism of a social category is evil. And I think it's a positive result of the book that representation is not just an expression of a particular scenario or an object. It's an invitation to come into particular relations with other people through shared understandings of telling episodes at the intersection of different worlds. Noticing how the case for Zomia makes any positive politics across difference seem categorically impossible, and the extent to which it draws on how anthropologists and historians had over generations been shaping Southeast Asian people as an object of knowledge, I don't want to blame Jim Scott. We're all in trouble. It seems to me that the binary of the state and the people is a recipe for political paralysis. And given that I'm working with people who are in the picture, I really want to resist that. I think I'll end there and see if you have any questions on this material. Thank you.
So in one of the two pieces that you published where you lay out some of the points of critique you've talked about today, you also take on Eric Wolfe. And the idea there is essentially that the frame of capitalism is inevitably the way that he then reconstructs, you know, relationships between the people without history and the Europeans and so on. And, you know, taking both that and your critique of Scott, I guess is one is sort of left to wonder whether or not the entire endeavor of maybe seeking anything that smacks of any characteristic similar to nomothetic theory might be just an empty enterprise, and whether or not you're basically just left to, okay, that all we can do really is then explain local cases and local situations. And I'm wondering what you think about that. Is that sort of where you stand with it?
Thank you. No, it's a very challenging question, and I may get myself in trouble trying to answer it. But no, I like it. I think it speaks to a generation of anthropology, that what Eric Wolfe did in his book, Europe and the People Without History, is to show that we had all been missing the transformation that had come with the expansion of capitalism across the globe since 1500. The reason I disagreed is that he makes this real by giving cases of the Mao, the Hmong, and others as the victims of the process, not just the victims of the expansion of capitalism. They become agents in the expansion of that transformative power that is ultimately very destructive. History is a force of destruction. Scott, with the state, is saying something similar. What I ended up doing was suggest that there's a generation of anthropologists who are a little bit like these Mian leaders who each establish their own contract. They're in competition for prominence with one another. So Eric Wolfe comes up with capitalism. Jim Scott, who's not necessarily an anthropologist, comes up with the state on the same material. Napoleon Chagnon comes up with biology, and Clifford Geertz comes up with culture. They're rushing to come up with the thing that is going to be like the key with which we play the anthropological instrument. This is what you should be going after. And when I was reading these scholars one after another or back and forth, it seemed to me they're giving us cases where harm is immaterial. So the destruction of capitalism need not be a destructive force, but it's made that from an analytical angle, and where any case of harm is actually an asset because it shows you how evil the thing is. And so I was reading Clifford Geertz on the cockfight in Bali, where he sets up, he's getting at Balinese culture and what's inside the heads of the Balinese people. In the process of setting up his case, there's a raid by the Javanese police force. And the police comes, they raid the place, this is an illegal activity, it has to stop. So Clifford Geertz and Hildred Geertz, they duck with the villagers behind a screen and pretend they were just drinking tea and talking like Balinese culture or something like that. The harm of police brutality by the Javanese police in the new nation state of Indonesia is an asset because it provides that instant rapport between anthropologist and his people. And I think, you know, we are reckless when we're coming into an anthropological case and we don't care what abuse happens to the people around us because it gives us a case. And I think we are dangerous. We need to sort of realize that we are in three different worlds at the same time. It isn't just that I deliver a piece of understanding to my appreciative readers. I may be thriving on harm. And I think it's like sampling. You may have heard the Henrietta Lacks case, biological sample that has been the one human cell that can be infinitely reproduced. There's something very problematic about that kind of sampling. And, you know, we have a license to look for ethnic groups. And I think that is a license we should be kind of careful with. Because I want to talk about me and people. I will never say I'm not writing about the experiences of both some me and in general and some me and in particular. I don't want to drop the ethnic label and call them Zomians because it's a denial of their specific historical experiences. And as sometimes stateless people, denying them specificity is to say you guys are all average and you lost your fight 50 years ago. So I think we have to be more careful. I'm all for big picture, big theory, but I think if we don't do it well with an awareness of how we may be taking advantage of our evidence, our cases, then it is just reckless plunder. So I may be getting myself in trouble saying that. Yes?
Well, I like this idea that you have of doing more than, you know, maybe capitalizing on their pain and suffering at times. Do you have an example of maybe how we can take this further to maybe make it social action anthropology or humane anthropology?
I think it's been done for a long time. Thank you very much. I think so many anthropologists have done it. So, like James Mooney in the late 19th century, right? Early 20th century. Jane Hanks with the Blackfoot. People have been, you know, people working in the inner city. There are so many people doing very important work that never is flashy. That there's something about what gets the attention of the New York Times or, you know, what hits, which is simplistic enough to be immediately comprehensible. I mean, we would all like that kind of attention, but we don't get it. You know, below the surface of top-noticed anthropology, there has always been very careful work. I'm not saying I invented this. No, but I see myself in the picture because I've written unflattering portraits of what the Thai state is doing in the process of making a Mian case, and I think it is irresponsible. But, it, you know, it got me past some review board because people out there with no stake in Thai society, no necessary knowledge of it, they think, yeah, that's an exciting case. So it is like, you know, kickboxing. It's an art, but for people who don't know the details of kickboxing, they just want to see a knockout. And there's a lesson there in that the league that owns mixed martial arts wanted to make a lot of money to make this into a pay-per-view television phenomenon. So they were told they had to make it safer to be palatable to the public. So they bring gloves on the hands of the boxers, which brings knockouts. So without gloves, if you try to knock somebody out, you break your hand. With gloves that look so safe, you really harm people. So, you know, being aware of what world we're in and who is put at risk is sometimes you gotta read up on boxing.
Yeah, I guess I'm kind of in that same world of just trying to figure that out, because obviously that is a reality of having to sell to somebody, and just I don't know. Yeah, if you have how do you do? I mean, are you saying we should be putting on the gloves, or we should be taking off the gloves? The metaphor is a little messy there, but I'm just, yeah, I'm trying to think about, so I often work in this highly overdetermined category of African-American inner city, add the other stuff, adolescent, you know, and that immediately conjures up something in the minds of the listener, the reader, the grant reviewer, that can, particularly in that last case, that can be marshaled in order to get money to do research, but it's painful to have to sort of, you know, do that and march out this, you know, stereotype in order to do that work. And I'm just wondering, yeah, how, is it, you know, a strategic thing to do do that in some cases and then work against it in other cases? How do you manage that?
I'm not very successful. I've not been getting grants for the work I want to do, if that's a measure. Nobody liked my book manuscript. Sorry. I don't know. I think it's an ongoing learning process. And, you know, whatever gets you into field situations, you know, we do whatever works. And then, you know, who we have to negotiate with, we have to find out. And there may be differences between, say, working in LA and in Chicago. There may be different political issues and issues of how we represent things and where we aim to publish. I think one of the problems I have with anthropology in this tribal zone here is that from the 1930s and almost until now, it's been aimed at a small group of peers who read academic journals and are interested in esoteric matters, and it's not been generally accessible. So the knowledge is only for a small group of fellow esoteric specialists, and I think it turned Highland people, it pulled them out of the region and turned them into a very exotic object that we can specialize in. And I think we're reaping the benefits of that with Scott's book, that he has a totally clear object. He turns it upside down and tells a very coherent story with it, and he gets enormous publicity for it. People love it. And being simply unhappy with the analysis doesn't change anybody's mind. Here's a curmudgeon-y academic who is jealous of Jim Scott for his book, whatever, you know? That we have to tell more accessible stories that bring out some of these complexities, because if we avail people who don't know better simplistic stories that are easy dramas or Friday afternoon, I think we do the world disservice, both at home and in the places where we do our research. So we have to kind of loosen up, maybe. It may or may not work, but so I don't have a good answer of how to do this. I wish I had.
Thank you.